So I really felt like I was getting tuned up, and so I relaxed into it and let these, I just observed this amazing array of grid-like moving filament energy things interacting with my own. Well, maybe they were my own, but they seemed like they were different than me. So so that went on for a long time, and then it slowly diminished, and I was pretty worn out. This is took about a couple of hours. Ayahuasca only lasts maybe 3 hours or four, and then I was just lying in the dark, and it started diminishing the energy of and the frequency and the intensity, and I wasn't seeing them quite so much, and they slowly faded away a little bit, and I was somewhat relieved on that. So by then, some people were going outside. Luma had said, you know, after a couple hours, if you're able to walk, you can go outside, but please don't wander away. Mm-hmm. Try to stay close to the cabin. So I went outside on the porch, overlooking the Russian River and some huge redwoods. And I sat in a nice chair, and because it was a starlit night with the moon, there were these huge redwood trees, and I was looking at them, and suddenly they became like patterns superimposed on what I was seeing, that were like, the patterns seemed like concepts. They were like new ideas coming and forming in my consciousness. So it was quite different than the first half of the trip, which was these iridescent glowing filament things that were healing and adjusting me. I got through the fear and all that, and now I was just sort of enjoying that new ideas, new understandings were coming. And it was really pretty nice. And it seemed to me, my big breakthrough, our big understanding was that what I was seeing with ayahuasca was what Teilhard de Chardin calls the Noosphere. And I had never made that connection before. And of course, I don't think Teilhard took any kind of psychotropics, but he did have some pretty intense experiences in the caves of Lascaux and Altamira in the dark and the silence when he was doing paleontology. And also on the front during World War I, he sensed a collective energy and that he missed when he actually went away from the front, even though it must have been horrible. He was a stretcher bearer and he probably saw pretty horrible injuries from mustard gas artillery, but he said he started sensing for the first time, and that's when he first sensed that there was a noosphere, a collective consciousness in a way. Wow. So that's pretty much the main part of the trip. After a while, I got tired of sitting outside, and I went inside and got back in my sleeping bag, and most people were doing the same thing and falling asleep. But I couldn't fall asleep for about an hour or so. I was lying there, and thoughts would come and go, and now and then a little visual. But finally I felt like sitting up and meditating, so I put my zafu, which I'd been using as a pillow, in front of the altar and wrapped my blanket around me and sat for an hour or two just trying to keep my mind clear and sense what was going on. And what I sensed pretty much was that I almost really felt like my IQ was given a boost, like about 10 points. I mean, that's a pretty random observation, but I felt like I had been re-energized and revitalized and my enthusiasm had been rekindled, and I just felt healthier and operating on a slightly, significantly more tuned up, very interesting new level. And I pretty much felt that all the way home. I drove home 230 miles and I'm thinking of writing an essay called Ayahuasca and the Noosphere, The Architecture of Consciousness. So my theory is that our normal egos are operated by our meat minds. I say meat minds meaning the two hemispheres of the brain that have the cognitive and mnemonic functions for remembering things and forming memories and recalling memories and thinking. And I believe we have two personalities in us, in the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere. So basically you have two sort of two avatar thinking meat components to your brain, which we mistake as that's being us. But I think the deeper us is what I saw, I really feel, is some kind of machine code level of programming. But there's a living, they were living things that normally operate like in a computer, like machine code. They do most of the work of repairing and healing and making connections and communicating. And it's almost like a beehive, a honeybee hive. And somewhere among all that must be the queen, which is what we take as our single consciousness. So I have to refine these theories and these thoughts, and that's why I'm recording this, hoping they don't fade away.